Who came up with this idea?
Might be a good thing to do.
He's already in focus. Just naturally focused.
I just always put myself into focus, don't worry. I don't even know if I was drawing as a kid. I don't have a lot of memories of what I used to do as a kid.
Huh. It wasn't that long ago.
I know. Well...
What do you consider a kid?
I don't know. I know people think I'm a kid, but I'm not.
Well, you're...
But I was young. One day. I'm young, but I'm not a kid, you know?
Yeah.
But people love to... love to think I am.
So the basic idea is to chat. Feel free to crosstalk. Feel free to curse. Feel free to do whatever. We run it uncut. So the idea is really to have a conversation.
I might be looking for my words, or, you know, I'm not always...
I'm completely fine with it.
I'm not always... well, I'm fluent, but I'm sometimes, you know, it's frustrating to me because I love languages so much. French, German, English, and I don't always find the proper words. Well, at least they're not as eloquent as I would like them to be, so. And that's frustrating.
Because of the language change, or because...
Well, because I know the words that I'd be using in French.
Right.
And you know, I love to pick the right words, some words that people would find, you know, precious or pretentious or whatever, but I like to be precise about the words that I choose. Mm. And sometimes it really annoys me to be looking, you know, for my words and striving for, you know... accuracy or just, you know, well constructed or structured sentence and just fail. Like, if you've interviewed me, you haven't, but anyone who's like interviewed me has probably already been annoyed by me asking constantly, what's the word for that in English? What's the word for that? How do you say, and then looking on my phone and people are like,
well, you know, Haneke, who speaks perfectly good English, when you're talking to him, won't go on camera without a translator. He just wants it to be precise. And speaks only in German on translation.
Yeah, and I actually know there's a guy who does subtitles and who's a great interpreter too. And he always travels with him, I think. Mm. Well, maybe not always, but his name is Robert Gray.
Mm-hmm.
He lives in Montreal, but he's also a moderator in Cannes. He will do most of the press conferences in Cannes. And I think he works with Haneke a lot.
Yeah. And he's very kind of self-motivated also. I mean, he wants to a credit on it, and he wants to be, like, he likes the fact that he's part of it. So a lot of translators just want to disappear into the background.
Yeah, and he loves to be...
He wants to get a credit. He actually asked for a credit once.
I couldn't, you know... I couldn't do that. I couldn't delegate the speech and my choice of words, and I have to be aware of every choice that I make. Like, I couldn't live with someone, and also I'm too curious about the language and the vernacular and the vocabulary and everything to just let go of it and be like, I don't care. I need to learn as much words as I can.
Well, I'm a colloquialist overall, so it's kind of interesting doing language conversations with people who don't speak English as their first language, because sometimes I lose them. In my colloquialisms.
I don't think you would lose me in colloquial. I mean, it's... I think I'd lose myself trying to sound, like, smart and not using the right words. But, you know, I get around. It's just that, you know, I remember when I was a kid, I was in my mom sent me off to boarding school, and there were a lot of Anglophones, you know, kids speaking in English, and I couldn't really understand, and it drove me fucking, you know, crazy. Mm. I was just like... And I really wanted to speak perfect English. I was like, I need to understand what they're saying. Huh. And then I started, you know, we have this, it's. I think it's an international thing. You have it here in America, and they have it everywhere in the world, but this school called Berlitz,
mm-hmm.
School of, like, Language.
Mm-hmm.
And I started taking lessons. I was a kid, I was a child actor, and I would pay for these classes myself.
Mm-hmm.
And this teacher called Donna, who's still part of my life, started having, you know, taking English classes with her when I was, I think, 8, and never stopped until I was 16. And what I would do is we understood at a certain point that I was like this sort of TV geek, and I was watching all those shows and recording them and taping them and then transferring them on my computer with the right codec and everything, burning DVDs. Yeah, I was crazy. I was insane. And I had this huge, like, book with all of the CDs and the DVDs of all the shows and every episode. And I actually, to this day, remember, because what would we do is we would watch them, her and I'd stop every time I didn't get a word. Mm. And she'd write it down if it was an idiomatic expression right. or slang or whatever, you know, and she'd write it down. And to this day, I remember every word that I've learned in my life. I remember what show, what episode, what character. It's you can be scared if you want.
Well, if you want, I'm a little older than you, a lot older than you. I'm probably twice your age. But when I went to college, I had a roommate. It was like VHS had happened, but it wasn't. We were certainly not in DVD yet. And my college roommate at NYU had every episode of MASH on audio tape.
Ooh.
And okay. He used to listen to them with his Walkman
wow.
on audio tape because he loved MASH so much.
Okay.
And he like was down to every detail.
That's next level.
Yeah,
that's,
it was a whole other...
I don't know that I got there. I might one day. Soon. Very soon.
Going deep, deep under. So I saw some of your interviews, actually, speaking English, after the movie premiered in Cannes. And you seemed a little pissed.
Did I embarrass myself?
No, but you did seem a little angry. You seemed a little frustrated and like...
Yeah.
And I actually, having seen the movie, pretty much agree with you. I think that certainly the Cotillard irritations or whatever the critics had were kind of stupid. Because I thought it was actually really interesting that she was going against what she does. She was playing something completely different than she usually plays,
yeah.
which was kind of great to watch.
I mean, I'm so very fond of her and I love her so much. And I'm very flattered that, as a matter of fact, she's actually very proud of that performance. I mean, she's not, you know, she's not all over the place and crying and screaming, and the others are, though. But, you know, she's into another dimension of acting. And I love that. I love that she's the only one who's listening. She's the only one who listens. She's the only one who's watching. She's the only one who gets what's going on. And who has a level of reading that's, you know, she reads under the surfaces, and she's just, so I appreciate that she is the one character that has a sense of the other, you know. Mm-hmm. She cares, and she notices, she sees, reads through, and I love that she is, well, not effaced, but she's, you know, not in the background, because she's very much there for mm-hmm. me. And I see everything she does, and I love everything she does in the film. But, of course, she is not as vocal and not as loud and not as and I don't understand the correlation between her celebrity and her notoriety and the fact that she should be vocal or screaming or given, you know, what the others are given. That's not her character. And that's mm-hmm. and I will always remember, you know, everyone had said yes. And I was waiting on Marion, and I was like, oh, she's going to say no, she's going to say no, I'm sure she's going to say no. And she called me very late at night, and it was late for me, it was even later for her, because she was in France. And so she was like, it must have been like, I don't know, 2 or 3 in the morning, and she was like, hey, it's Marion, I read your script, I think it's, she loved it, she thought it was beautiful, and then she said exactly this. I don't really know. I can't really get my head around that woman. I don't really understand mm-hmm. what I'm going to do. I don't know how I'm going to do. I'm going to act. I don't know how I'm going to build this character, and I'm scared. But I also think that for all those reasons, I want to do it for those reasons. Mm-hmm. And it impressed me so much because, you know, when you're scared and when you doubt and when you don't see immediately where you're going and where you're headed, you're like, oh, that's a red flag. And she had exactly those apprehensions and those feelings, but they actually prompted her to say yes and jump into yeah. the she knew that we would be walking through, you know, the fire, and that we would, and it was one of the most extraordinary experiences of my life directing mm-hmm. an actress. It was amazing. We found each other, and I am forever grateful towards her for this towards her for the open-mindedness and the courage, the curiosity of going into the unknown. So when the reviews, you know, said she was boring or underexploited, I'm like, which would be to say that when you are an actor who's been lauded as extraordinary, you know, as a major talent in her generation and in the scenery of actors, that you can only be given certain roles where you are exploited to your most, you know, optimal values. So you gotta scream, you gotta cry, you gotta, you know, just it's a very poor understanding of what acting is.
Well, she usually play. I mean, I think the thing is that she usually plays this extreme intelligence that's always very fierce and very focused. And this woman, from the minute you look at her in this film, her face is open in a different way. Her eyes are kind of bright and shiny, and she's not stupid, but she has that. I mean, obviously she's not stupid. She has a She is listening and hearing things, but she has this kind of softness and lack of kind of the sharpness of intelligence that you usually expect from her. And I think that's maybe what threw people off.
I just think her intelligence in this film is not as developed as her sensibility.
Right.
But she clearly is very intelligent. She's just not expressing it in a you know, it's to me, there's a scene where she is sitting with the young hero of the film, the younger protagonist who's coming home to tell his family he's going to die. And she's sitting with him for the people who haven't seen this film, so I'm guessing mm-hmm. everyone. they're sitting together and everybody's talking and they're actually screaming and giving each other hell and about something, you know, unimportant such as how you're dressed or whatever, and they're just fighting and it's just, you know, it's mindless chatter again and again and again and again. And the lead character sinks into his own mind, and he's just, you know, getting lost in all this and just thinking, oh my God, how am I going to tell my family I'm dying with all the shit that's going on? And she's sitting right next to him, and she has, with the years, she's become herself, you know, quite indifferent to that sort of energy and atmosphere, people just, you know, picking at each other. So she's just herself withdrawing from that and looking at him and asking if he's all right. And then she sees in his eyes, she has this sort of arc that goes from, and I remember being on set and doing this with Marion, like I was on my knees and she's here and I'm here and I was talking to her and I'm like, okay, so first you look at him with your smile and then you ask him if he's all right and then you look at him in a different way, tilting your head like this, and then you look down and look back and suddenly the smile thrives. You lose your smile and you understand that he's dying. And we did that whole arc together, and that to me is like one of the most, a piece of acting, a moment in a performance that I'm the most proud of in my entire life, because there are no words, there are no tears, there are no, you know, there's nothing rewarding here. There's nothing, well, there are things that are rewarding to me, but it's not, you know, right. There's no, she's not showing off, she's not, you know, there's nothing. There's just the silence and the eyes. And she did that so well. And to me, I mean, there's a lot of acting in this film, and there are a lot of screams, there are a lot of words. But none of them are as powerful, I think, almost none of them are as powerful as this look she's giving him.
What's interesting, because Vincent, later, I'm forgetting his character name, sorry, but he talks about,
you
forgot it too?
Yeah.
That he, you know, people who are quiet are not necessarily listening.
Yeah.
And in some ways he is, in some ways he isn't. She is a completely different emotional embodiment of that same reality. She's the empath, she's a true empath.
Yeah.
And he is not really, though he occasionally hears things that he's not supposed to be hearing. But, or you don't think he's hearing, but
yeah.
It's an interesting pairing in that way.
Well, they're completely, you know, they're complementary in a way that you know, they complete each other. She is the ears and he's the mouth. He's just shouting and shouting and shouting, saying everything he hates and everything but he understands everything. This family, you know, they understand everything. They feel everything. Mm-hmm. They just verbalize it in a very messy and disorderly way. But and they talk, but they don't really talk to each other. She's not from that family. Mm-hmm. She is from another upbringing. She's from another energy, another type of compassion, and she's learned other things. She's been brought up in a different way. This is part of your education, listening to others or not. It really is. Mm-hmm. And I love that there would be a stranger in there to sort of create a sense of balance.
So you were a child actor, you're a kid actor.
Yeah.
Were you always going to be a director?
No.
What made you think that was a good idea?
Because I wasn't acting anymore. Oh, shit, I'm destroying your kid's material. Drawing. drawing kit.
We'll get him another pencil.
Sorry. No, I you know, I was acting a lot as a child, and then I was sent to boarding school, which was far away from home, and mm-hmm. which wasn't ideal for auditions and, you know, casting calls and stuff. So I couldn't go anymore, and then I, you know, sort of stopped working. And then when I was back in town, I was like 16, and yeah, I guess I was really, really, you know, I missed acting so much. I still am, actually. And I've never stopped acting ever since. I act every once in a while. Mm-hmm. And with time, it's really what I'm going to do more and more.
So what you really want to do is act? Mm-hmm. It's the opposite of the old line.
Oh, yeah, 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 it's true. Yeah, you hear about a lot of actors who become directors because they're tired of, I guess they want to, their search for control and precision is just mm-hmm. quenchless, and they're not satisfied with working with other directors, which I can understand. I understand that. But being a director, I give a lot to actors, and we exchange a lot, and the collaboration is just very, there's a mutuality that can be consuming. I give a lot of my, like, I want to share all of my ideas, but sometimes, you know, someday I'm like, oh, I would love to use those ideas for myself. Mm-hmm. Not out of selfishness or because I'm a creator and I want to create things myself too. I love to create with others, but I want to be creating them for someone, like another director. Just so
you were home and you weren't working.
I was home and 16. I wasn't working, yeah. And so I thought, if I wanted to, well, I dropped out of college actually when I was 17, and that's when I wrote my first film. I killed my mother, and then I thought, if. If I write the story and if I direct it myself, no one's going to tell me you're not right for the part, right? First, it's the part of my life, I guess. I was playing myself as a teen. Mm. There are not a lot of, you know, nuances between this film and what my actual teenagehood was like.
Mm. So did you get money from the Canadian government, or how did you go about?
No, not for the first one. It was turned down by the institutions, and I had to invest my child acting savings,
wow.
The money that I had, yeah. Which was good, because then came the September 2008 crash, and a lot of people lost a lot of money.
You'd already spent it on a movie.
I lost it, but in a positive way, you know, I invested it instead of just losing it. Mm.
So the reaction on that was good enough to get you to the next, pushing you towards Mommy, ultimately?
Well, there are three films between.
Right.
After I Killed My Mother, there's Heartbeats, Lawrence Anyways, and Tom of the Farm.
Oh, Lawrence Anyways, I completely forgot about that. I'm sorry.
No, it's fine. I'm just telling you that the yeah, but the reaction, yeah, I don't think it's the reaction that prompted me to make another film. It was just the immediate desire for more storytelling, more acting, more. Like, when I directed I Killed My Mother, there were a lot of things that I just didn't know and didn't understand, and really it wasn't clear to me where to put a camera, and I just tried a lot of things and explored, and a lot of these things were just clumsy and very, you know, you're playing around with things and ideas and trying to find yourself, and the search for myself was the need to find myself, I think, in an unconscious way, was very much what drove me, what was driving me. And then, yeah, Heartbeats, Lawrence Anyways, Tom of the Farm, Mommy. And it's really when I did Mommy that I was like, okay, now I'm making the movies that I like. Mm. Now I'm making the movies that I would want to see. I'm making the movies that are me. I
don't
found
even,
myself.
Well,
I'm still finding
that.
Myself. I will yeah. find myself forever because you're evolving and changing. But
even before that, I think even with like Lawrence Anyway, I was there in Cannes for that premiere, and it was already kind of about you as much as it was about the movie. You already had kind of like this very large footprint for a young man who had just made a couple movies, and you know, it was kind of fascinating. And did you see that? Is that sound familiar to you, or you?
Well, yeah, I guess. What do you mean exactly?
Well, I mean, I think a lot of the conversation was about you as an auteur, and you were truly a title above, a name above a movie, in what seemed like almost a premature way. You know, it's like, as you say, Mommy kind of became the moment of even greater transition, but those films put you in an interesting position at a very young part of your career and your life.
Yeah. Not to my request.
Right.
I would never want to put myself before, you know, above the title of a film and at the front of it's just, that's not a decision you make. Yeah, because I don't need to promote myself as anything. Like, I don't care. I don't want a career in life. I just want to tell stories and I also want to act. But to me, it's really about the work. I'm really passionate about the work. Mm. I'm passionate about filmmaking. I'm passionate about costumes. I'm passionate about actors. And it's really about who you work with, the actors you work with, the people, the artists with whom you create and work. That's what matters to me. So, yeah, I think the age has always created that sort of persona, that sort of what you're talking about, the fact that there'd be a footprint or a strong, you know, reputation or whatever, but I never really wanted that. Mm. That's not something, you know, useful or that you want to use to work or grow. So, but I guess I was the age that I was when I was in Directors for a Night for the first time with I Kill My Mother, and then the year after we went for with Heartbeats at Certain Regard, and then Lawrence Anyways. And you know, back at the time, I remember, you know, I was 21, 20, 22 with Lawrence Anyways, and we were dreaming of being, you know, in competition then. And you know, yourself, of course you do, that before Cannes, there were always, you know, everyone is writing about what they're, you know,
prognosticating.
Yeah, exactly. And the rumors and the word in the hall and on a street, and they're like, this is going to be there, this for sure is going to make it, this is sure to be. And when you're 22, you know, and you've been spending like months editing a film and pacing and having sleepless nights of wondering, you know, am I going to get in, and where is this film going, and are people going to understand this film? And you read these things and you're like, oh my God, they think there might be a chance. And then, you know, when we found out we were not, you know, and that we were going back to the sidebar, the Certain Regard, which with time I completely understand was much preferable. But life is not about understanding and knowing everything immediately now. Life is about understanding the value of certain things later. That's what makes the value of time. But it was as though everyone was expecting me and us to have a very mature reaction about this. Well, we, you know, whereas we had been fed with all of the confident convictions of everyone that we would be there. And on the day we had interviews in Montreal, and there was one, you know, we were asked, well, are you disappointed? You know, you were rumored to be most certainly going to be a part of that competition. And I just said, yeah, sure, of course. It's disappointing, but I'm really happy to be part of the Cannes Film Festival anyway. It's a great selection. Mm-hmm. And then that was it. And then I remember the morning after, the headlines were just, I remember that journalist had written exactly this. Xavier Dolan is going back to Cannes and he is not happy, in all caps. And I was like, oh, I don't remember saying that. And the whole festival that year for me had been trying to explain to people I was not some sort of monster who was just whining about being back in Canada. I was like, no, you don't understand. I was just asking a question, and I said I was disappointed. I'm a human being. Mm-hmm. And if I tell you that you are going to Cannes and that you are not going finally, or that you are going to cover, you know, only the movies I don't know what is an image that would measure to that, but
yeah.
Everyone is entitled to despond and being sad about things, and it's just, I don't understand why we live in a time where people can't commiserate and just be like, yeah, sure, that's disappointing, but let's move right the fuck along, you know?
The urge to create hype is certainly a...
The urge to hate as well, and the urge to make sensational, you know, scandalous figures, and just, it was just a 22-year-old person saying, I'm disappointed, but I'm really happy. Mm-hmm. And it I feel that is one of the things that when you talk about the footprint, when you talk about the name above the film, that is one of the things for me that, in spite of all my efforts to just try to break that and say, no, I'm happy to be here, it always haunted me. And years after, people are still, you know, talking about this and saying how monstrous it was and how narcissistic it was and I'm like, oh.
Well, it's funny because in other interviews you talked about hate and about, certainly in talking about the situation with Marianne, it also was, you know, kind of frustrating for you. And at the same time, I feel like you also have gotten the benefits of enormous amounts of love from the media community and from critics and from, you know, a lot of people who watch your movies who really love what you do.
I would say people who watch the movies. I wouldn't say I got a huge, like, there's always been...
Well, maybe it's just film comment. I don't know. No, but, you know, it's the high-end critics or...
I don't think it's a matter of high-end, you know. You can have high-end people who hate or love, or I wouldn't say all the high-end people, you know, hate my films and all the lower... I don't think of critics like that, you know. You watch movies and you have opinions and whatever outlet you work for, it's...
Well, I don't mean that. I don't mean by outlet. I just mean by I think there's a different mentality amongst critics who actually are critics, because we have so many people who are critics now,
I think people see me as their kid or as their student, and I feel like my movies are homework. And they're, you know.
Well, I think some people are like, I don't think serious critics look at you like that. Well, I think they're looking to see your work, and they really care about what it is, and they don't really care whether you're 20 or 600, you know. You could be Oliveira, and they would still try to see, if they're a serious film critic, they'd still care about
what it is. Well, I couldn't be anymore, technically. Isn't he dead?
Did he finally die? I feel like he has another movie coming out next week. I think he may have finally died at 104.
Maybe in a posthumous way, but I was...
No, I think he finally went 103, 104.
That's terrible. That's a terrible conversation.
He had a film minutes ago. He had a film last year, but he may have been also passed away at the time it came out.
I thought he had, but maybe I'm wrong.
When you're 103, it's all up for grabs.
You know.
By the time you're 103, you have 87 films. Yes, exactly.
But
anyway, so you don't feel like you're getting that love... as much as you feel like you're kind of being poked at.
The thing is, listen, when you make films about emotions and about, and I feel that's what they are for now, emotions, lots of emotions and lots of people, you know, who have their heart on their sleeves and who are just, you know, fighting for love, fighting to fit, fighting for their identity, for their place in society. When you do that, you can't just... You're not sitting on a chair and saying, yeah, sure, let's do one more take. It's just, you're involved in a way that, when I say I'm passionate about this, you know, you have to understand this is all my life. This is all I've got. This is, anything in between is a boring and long parenthesis in which I'm pretending to be happy and healthy, and I'm not. So, when I'm on set with someone like Marion or someone like Andrew Val or Suzanne Clément, I live, you know, I'm alive and I exist. And and so you give everything and you give your all, and then they leave. They leave and they go to, you know, on with other endeavors and their lives. I don't. I stay with the film for months and months and months alone. Not so alone, one or two people around me, and then one person around me. I just change family, you know. I just frolic from one department to the other, and in that search for, you know, the finality of a film. And then you go to Cannes, and then you premiere, and then on to the next one. But it's a very lonely process. And so when you do that, you have to be committed in a total and entire way. And there are no compromises that can be made in terms of how you commit yourself. You do it 100% or you don't. And I do it 100% and more, I guess, because I dedicate myself entirely to this work and this job. And so, and in order to get these emotions right, when you're on set, when you're editing, when you're scoring the film, when you got to put yourself in a you know, like the shutter of your heart is wide open. You're emotionally open, and you can't just shut that down. Because suddenly you're going to be in Cannes and you got to be tough. It's not how, that's not how it works. You're emotionally open on your, or you're not. You're an artist who is dedicated to emotions or dedicated to something else. Then maybe you're strong and smart about critics, and maybe you're like, well, it's all right. You don't have to like my film, you know, to each his own. And you can be politically correct, and you can, I can't. And I guess I'll be hated and criticized for that. But at least I'll make films that are authentic and that are, and I might be the only one thinking that. But the response towards the film in France, the people in tears, the mail we've been getting, the tweets every day, it's just, they've been proving me that this film has reached the heart of people, and that's really what matters. But because you asked about Cannes, and everybody asks me about it, and I wish we could just pretend it's gone, it's just history, but the truth is that it's left a scar and a wound, and I've been trying to just move on and be like, this is okay, it's okay, it happens. Not every film is going to be, you know, some people are entitled to disliking things and having their own opinions, and of course that's how criticism works, but I just feel it is the style and tone and insistence in which we criticize and vocally and in quite a gratuitous way hate things now that is questionable. But who am I to
I love Cannes, and I also feel that is true there more than any place else on earth, that during that week, the 10 days, that critics are almost ramped up in a way to either love too much or hate too much. It's the passions that are shown are so insane at times.
And I appreciate the passion. You know?
But it gets lost. It breaks from reality. I mean, part of the job of being a critic is to feel the movie, but also there's a degree of professional objectivity that you should maintain. So when somebody like von Trier gets, you know, roasted the way he has for some things he said are they're stupid, but the work is fascinating and still of value and still has things, and you know, unless you're Godard, you don't get a pass. Everybody else is under this thing where it's like there's this measuring that is, I find, that weak, and I think it changes 6 months later, it may be different, but people are so intense that
I did say that. I did say that to one critic who tweeted me something very cruel. I was like, you'll love it in September.
Well, a lot of people do, and I mean, their critics have been. I mean, I've always said the critics of Variety have been so wrong about so many movies at Cannes, just on the face of it, and you like, how, because of politics or whatever. But, and then 6 months later, it's a hit movie here, and you're like, oh yeah, okay, obviously.
But it's also that what really irritates me is that, you know, for the past years of my life, I've been collecting reviews, negative reviews, trying to decipher. Sorry. Okay. See?
Very closely.
So, you know, what exactly have they... Okay, what have they seen? What did they think? What did they... Oh, is this... Okay, so this is what I should change. This is what can be, you know... This is what can get better here. This is what can be improved. This is... Oh, this I don't agree. This is... This that's their own... And that's been a fascinating exercise for me. Mm-hmm. And try to, you know, understand what I did wrong and what I did right and how I can become better. But then, you know, it irritates me that after all these years of being open-minded and actually having a lot of curiosity towards criticism, that I would be that I would look like this person who's completely intolerant of criticism, while I remain fascinated and open-minded towards it, and I just want to soak it all in, and. Soak it all up. Soak it all in
is good.
Anyway.
Soak it all up is okay too.
But this time around, I couldn't find anything in there where I was like, I was reading, and I didn't read a lot. Like, I usually read everything. I didn't this time because I was like, okay, I understand that we misunderstood each other completely here. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't find anything about my film. Like, it was really only about really... Yeah.
Cam.
Me, I guess, yeah. And you know, so I just don't know if that's gonna be, there was a moment where I came back home and I was like, oh, is this going to be like what the rest of my life is going to be like? I was having conversation with people and they were like, you're just going to have to brace for the, you know, get ready for the fact that this is going to be what your life is going to be. And I'm like, I don't want this to be my life. I don't want to, you know, I want to make movies to get better and I want to make movies to reach out to people. I don't want to make, like, I want to grow up and become a better human being and a better artist, but my fight is not going to be, I'm not going to fight people. I'm not going to justify myself. I don't want this to be my life. I don't want my purpose to be, God, please let me please them. Let me please them. Let me, you know, please, dear God, let them love me.
Well, the glory of Cannes for me and for almost all film festivals and seeing movies early before, you know, they're criticized in public or whatever, is not knowing. It's the kind of the joy of it is to go into a movie and not quite knowing what you're getting and just watching the movie and really experiencing the movie. And because of whatever degree of celebrity you've attained already, and other filmmakers are in the same position on some level at Cannes, like, you know, Hassan Avissis got obliterated for making a movie that was not terrible. It just wasn't, you know, The Artist or whatever. I mean, I don't think they like The Artist that much as critics, but it wasn't, somehow it was just torn down because it wasn't what they were expecting. And I think that happens far too much at film festivals. But that's also the great thing about film festivals, the discovery
it is.
And the
it is.
What's new.
This year was just, you know, all of my films have been very divisive and I've had very harsh reviews in the past. I survived them. I was like, okay, interesting. This year was just a little different. It was just a bit too much for me.
So the people who are clearly loving you are actors. This film is an all-star roster of French actors. Your next film is an all-star roster of American actors. Clearly actors want to be in your space and work with you.
And I want them to be in my space, so that's
And that sounds
great.
Like that's your goal. It sounds like you're getting, even though you may be slapped from some people outside that you don't care for. It
but
sounds
I do
like the
care
people who you
them.
Most
that's
care
the, that's
about.
That's the love-hate thing. I do. I can't say I don't care about that.
Right.
But you're right.
But it sounds like the thing you most care about you have achieved.
Yeah.
Is you've drawn kind of actors that you want to work with who can change the game for you and teach you in working with them as much as you want to learn.
Yeah. That's the reward of the work and thank God these. I'm always amazed and quite flattered, to be honest, at how aware actors are. Like, I have so little time in my life to sit down and just enjoy watching a film, discovering. And actors seem like they're always aware. They always watch movies. They know who is directing this and who's the... And you're like, okay. It's just, I'm amazed at how educated they are about everything in every country and every director and every new and so it's a privilege for me to be talking with someone and I'll be like, well, I directed a film called, and they're like, yeah, and I'm like, oh, okay. And that's just very humbling, obviously. Yeah. And as long as there is a great encounters with actors, new friendships, new encounters, and as long as there is creation, I'd rather to be in creation than in reacting to whichever critic or whichever criticism. You know, it's I should learn with time to focus on what matters.
And was there much of a difference working with a bunch of American English-speaking actors and doing a film in English?
No, which is, I guess, what was wondrous is that you have your way, you have your ways, your vision of what the relationship between you and an actor can be, and as idiosyncratic as that can be, and as I think sometimes it can be a little discombobulating for an actor to be talked to during takes and be given inflections or whatever, but I'm an actor. The only way that I know to direct actors is talking to them and acting with them. I'm not like I said, I'm not the guy sitting in a chair and not really talking to you and being like, yeah, let's do it one more time. And like the actor is like, why? Can I know why? Can I know what I have to change? What I have to do differently? Or I love to be, if you're here, I'm on my knees next to you and I have the little monitor and I'm like, and I'm like pulling on your sleeve. I really don't ever want to see my face in the last seconds of that interview. I'm going to be so ugly. I don't know what I did. It looks like I had actually a stroke. I am the interaction with the actor is constant. And as much as I'm always a little scared that actors will not react well to that, they always sort of do react well. And we get along very well. And there's nothing that I love more than acting, than directing actors. That's where I really feel fulfilled and in my place.
And will you be scared when they invite you to Cannes with this one?
Sure.
Because of the last one?
Mm-hmm.
She's just a little gun shy.
Hmm?
A little gun shy. But you'll go.
You know, people have always asked me, and they always ask you, I think, so, that's a lot of pressure, right? You must feel a lot of pressure. You must, And the answer to, thus far was always, no, I don't feel pressure. I'm happy. I'm doing the job that I like. I'm meeting extraordinary artists. I'm working with Gabriel Yared, who scored The English Patient, and who is, I think, literally a genius. I'm very lucky to be doing this job. And I had never thought about the pressure. I had never felt the pressure. And like I said, I was emotionally open when I came to Canvas here. I was ready not to be, I was ready for mixed reviews. I was ready for a lot of different scenarios. I just didn't expect that. So, yeah, I just didn't have my bulletproof jacket and I just arrived at Cannes like this. Not in a pretentious way. I meant, in a natural open way. And I was just like ready for the, I guess I was lucky all those years.
And will you be as open this time or will you have a little bulletproof vest under your jacket?
No, yeah. Like I told you, I'll be scared. That's the thing about it. That's the thing where I'm like, do I want to go back and do, and no, yes, I want to go back. And no, nothing will ever impeach that and will never, keep me from submitting my work to them. But yeah, I'll be like, maybe I'll leave my phone home. I don't know.
Can you ever see not looking at the reviews and not looking at the external voices?
Well, I don't want to do that because I want to know what people think.
But don't you?
I want to know how people feel. I want to know what they see.
But isn't it about how you feel?
No. Because the thing is, I don't make movies for myself. I make movies for other people. And without them, without their appreciation, without their feelings, I'm lost. Mm. And I'm, walking in the dark, touching myself, and that's not, I'm sure that can be fun, but I need to know if they see black, well, I'm thinking white, if they see long, when I'm thinking short, if they see cold, when I'm thinking warm and emotional, then I'm like, okay, well, we have a real problem here. What I said before is I can't spend my life trying to please a group of 25 people who are moving in wolf packs and who are just, and who are actually people that I respect and whose articles make me laugh or make me think. It's another thing when the gun is turned against, you.
Yeah.
I guess that even though I've been, affected deeply, it wouldn't keep me from reading and looking because I'm passionate about this and I think the only way to remain passionate, remain precise, and remain good is to be interested in what other people see. If you're not interested in that, then you're talking to yourself. You're doing things for yourself and you are imprisoning yourself in this own world of yours where you lose sense of touch and the sense of you just yeah, I don't want to grow cold. I don't want to grow indifferent. I can't. I'd rather be hurt again than being alone with my films. I can't afford that. So I'll probably be hurt again. That's almost a certainty.
And do you stay in love?
My drawing.
Forever? Do you stay in this romance with your work, with the whole thing forever? Are you still there with your earliest films, or is there a point where you kind of, I'm done, I put that aside and I moved on to the other work?
What do you mean?
Well, emotionally, there's a lot of filmmakers certainly have a switch where they're kind of like, okay, the print, you know, we premiered, done the press, I'm on to the next thing, my head is somewhere
else.
Oh, sure.
Oh, yeah, you move on. You just, and yeah, normally, you know, this, when I'm, normally when I'm editing a film, I normally have one or two scripts on, you know, the fire. I'm just... Mm-hmm. I'm cooking, you know. I'm nervous because I'm like, what's next? Hello. I'm like, sure. You move on, you know, and that's. But as much as it's easy to move on to the next film, it doesn't mean I forget about the others,
right.
and the past, and especially not the disappointments, and the things that marked me. Or hurt me, which is why we're talking about it, and I wish we wouldn't have.
Sorry.
No, it's fine. I just... I don't know. People think I'm just obsessed with that. Well, all I'm trying to do is sort of move on, and really, it's not... I'm not thinking... I mean, if people don't bring it up, I don't wake up in the morning and think about this.
Right.
I think of, you know, what's next.
And well, success and disappointment for filmmakers who have, you know, some standing and some time is always a fascinating thing. And some, as I say, some people do cut themselves off from it and just say, you know, some are bad and some are good and I'm moving on. And you're, you know, clearly you have an emotionality in the work and in the response that is what makes you you.
Well, I can move on, you know. I'm not stuck
right.
in the past thinking, what happened? You know, I've shot a film ever
right.
since. I'm writing a new one. I'm maybe writing another one, like a second other one.
Mm-hmm.
I'm inspired. I'm happy. I love meeting new people. Life goes on for sure. But since we're talking about it, I guess that wound hasn't completely scarred.
Yeah, and this one is still open. I mean, this going on. It's not, you know, over. You're still showing the movie to people. Still,
yeah,
people are just beginning to see it.
Exactly.
Really,
that's
in this country.
Yeah. Well, I mean, not that they will. This right. film won't be seen by anyone here.
Well, anyone is a relative concept.
I mean, well, not no anyone. Well, you know, the industry here. You are seeing it. People are seeing it. But
yeah.
it's not going to be released.
So it's going to be a directed streaming or.
Maybe not even. I don't even know. It's not been. Yeah, it's not been.
Huh.
It's. I don't even think it's gonna go on Netflix or iTunes or whatever. I don't know. I don't know how people in the States will be able to watch it.
We will somehow end up being able to watch it.
I don't know how exactly.
I certainly don't know.
But I will do my best. But it's a very frustrating thing.
Yeah.
But you know, we're trying to be creative, and we'll certainly find a way. But for now, it is not at all. It doesn't seem like a possibility.
Mm. I had a conversation with Neil Jordan once after one film at Toronto, and he has, you know, obviously won Academy Awards and done all this stuff. And he was like, "This is the first time I have a film where I'm not sure whether it's going to actually be seen in the United States." It was kind of freaking him out, I think, at the time.
Who?
Neil Jordan, who did Crying Game and,
mm-hmm.
you know,
yeah,
the
sure.
vampire
sure.
and got everything. But he was, like, having that moment where it's like, of course it's been on TV and everywhere else since then. But he was,
yeah.
like, not, he had not already bought it. Nobody, you know, there wasn't a place for it. There are a lot of films that live in that kind of weird ether from some very significant filmmakers.
Yeah, well, I think the market is very intricate at the moment, very craving things that are not necessarily... everyone's specialty.
Yeah. But the specialized stuff, I think people have, there is a market for it. People, you know, just a smaller market.
This film has been sold everywhere in the world.
Yeah.
In every country. It's been released in most of them. And it's doing fine, and people are writing, and they're going, and it's super touching, and they're writing on Instagram, they're reaching out, they're taking photos, we're doing the Korean DVD, but it's not been sold here.
No.
It's just an hour and a half long film on a guy who's going home for an afternoon. I don't know. There are some cultural nuances, I guess, that don't translate very well.
I don't know. One of my favorite Ozone films is one of the films that barely got seen, which is Time to Leave, which has resonance with this film.
I love Time to Leave.
And I love that film. It's one of my favorite films.
It's never been released here in the States?
It had, I think it ended up being maybe Strand, you know, and got a few screens.
Well, Strand is a release.
Well, Strand is a release.
Strand is a release.
But, I mean, it's like barely, I talk to people about the film, and, like, they never heard of it.
It's one of my favorite Ozone. I haven't seen all his work. I haven't seen all his films. But this is a film that I really like.
Yeah, I think it's one of the great
films. It's made me want to work with Melville, who was the lead of Lawrence anyways.
Right. Yeah, no, tremendous movie. And, yeah. But I had a conversation about that film and about other films of his. Like, why don't you just, make a deal and give him... Because the films are all under $2 million. He's never made a film that costs more than $2 million.
Really?
I'm like,
I don't know.
Why don't you just... Somebody just finance his film. You can make that money on DVD and just, you know... have an artist as part of your repertoire.
I don't know. We'll probably just... I don't know. It'll go on iTunes or... Or maybe we should call Netflix or something. I don't know.
Well, I'll call you. Pleasure. Thank you very much. Thanks for
coming.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you. I wish it wouldn't always be about me whining about that damn can thing.
Well, but next year it won't be. It'll be something else.
Me.
Next year it'll be about the next movie.